everybody. Today we're going to be learning about classical conditioning. Classical conditioning is different from operant conditioning in that with operant conditioning, you have to actively do something before you can be conditioned. You don't have to do anything exciting or difficult, but you got to do something. With classical conditioning, on the other hand, it's a much more passive process. You don't really have to do anything to be conditioned other than basically not be dead. Or in some cases, you have to be conscious, but that's about it. And what makes classical conditioning, it's sometimes called associative learning, because it occurs when people, or animals for that matter, learn to associate one stimulus with another. And because of that, they exhibit a response in reaction to some new stimulus. So we're going to go through an example in a moment, but first I want to give you some basic terminology here, because the words stimulus and response sound like they should be pretty self-evident, but I have learned that people actually do often misunderstand what those terms mean. So first of all, in classical conditioning, a stimulus, frankly, can be pretty much anything. It can be a person, something you hear, something you see, something you think. It can be pretty much anything. So a gas stove, if any of you have ever burned your hand on a stove, after a while you'd learn that when you see it, you should be a little bit fearful. A pop quiz, some of you might sort of start feeling nervous if you hear those words. Or the McDonald's logo could be a stimulus. If you've ever had that experience where you're driving around and you're really not that hungry, and then you see a McDonald's logo and you're like, oh, but now I could go for some fries, right? So you have come to associate that logo with the taste of French fries or burgers or whatever. So that's a stimulus. It can be pretty much anything. On the other hand, a response can only be, in classical conditioning, it can only be a bodily reaction or an emotion. So remember, in operant conditioning, the word response was used to mean a voluntary behavior. And I will be the first to admit that it's confusing to have that same word mean two different things. And if I ruled the world, maybe we'd find a different word and be clear about it, but I do not rule the world. So in classical conditioning, a response can only be one of two things, a bodily reaction or an emotion. So you can feel pain, feel happy, cry, sneeze, blink, have your heart rate go up, feel tense. Anything like that can be a response. But anything that you then do voluntarily, like if you run away from something or you hit a person, now we're also getting into operant conditioning because that's a voluntary action that you initiate. Okay, so we've got a stimulus that can be pretty much anything. A response can be a bodily reaction or an emotion. So the example I'm going to give you here is kind of a similar one to what you learned about with Pavlov's dogs, but one that you may be more likely to have seen in your own lives. So before classical conditioning can occur, what we need is an unconditioned stimulus. This is something that triggers an unlearned response. So unconditioned means unlearned. And by this, we mean that this requires zero prior knowledge. So for example, and UCS, UCR means unconditioned stimulus and unconditioned response. Okay. So for example, if someone hits you on the head, it doesn't matter if you've ever been hit on the head before. It doesn't matter if you know it's coming. You can sit there all you want and be like, it won't hurt, it won't hurt. But it's going to hurt and you're going to feel pain. Same thing if we turn off the lights, your pupils will dilate. If you have enough caffeine, your heart rate will go up. It makes no difference if you have ever had caffeine in your life before. It doesn't matter if you take it voluntarily or not. This requires zero learning on your part and you have no control over it. So this is one of the things that we need before conditioning can occur. The second thing we need is a neutral stimulus. So something that produces no particular response, okay? Like if I walked up to one of you and said the word Tuesday, you'd probably look at me and think I'm a little weird, but it's not like you're going to have a strong emotional reaction. Oh my God, she said Tuesday. So that's your neutral stimulus. In the example we're going to give here, if you have a cat, first time it ever hears an electric can opener, whatever, it's a noise. It might pick up its head, it might notice, but it's not going to be particularly excited or afraid or anything like that. But now we get into the actual classical conditioning. And what we're going to do is repeatedly pair the neutral stimulus with that UCS. So in this case, remember the neutral stimulus is the can opener, and we are going to pair it with yummy, delicious cat food. And we're going to do this over and over and over again. The cat's going to hear the can opener, and then it's going to get yummy cat food. And then it'll hear the can opener again, and it'll get cat food again. And we're going to do this a bunch of times. How many times we need to do it will depend on a whole host of other factors, but we'll do it a bunch of times. And eventually what happens is that neutral stimulus stops being neutral. And it's now going to be called the conditioned stimulus, the CS, because it's learned, it's conditioned. So now, even when there's no cat food, this cat is going to get excited when he hears a can opener because he's like, oh my gosh, I know that sound. And that sound by itself has meaning for that cat. Just like the McDonald's logo might come to have meaning for you if it is repeatedly paired with the taste of food that you enjoy. So conditioned responses, sometimes they are the same as the unconditioned response. One way to see this for yourself is go home, go into your bathroom. You need a room where you can make it really dark and where you can look into a mirror. And now make some noise. Clap your hands, snap your fingers, whatever. So let's say you clap your hands, turn off the light. Your eyes are going to dilate. Now turn the light back on. Wait a little bit, let your eyes go back to normal, and do it again. Clap your hands, turn off the light, let your eyes dilate. Do this maybe like 15 or 20 times. Somewhere around the 20th time, don't turn off the light. Just clap your hands and look into the mirror, your eyes will dilate. And the whole point is that it doesn't matter that you knew it was coming. It doesn't matter that you're doing it to yourself. This is literally the muscles in your eye learning the clapping sound is followed by darkness, and they're responding in anticipation of that darkness. So in this case that I just gave you, the conditioned response is the same as the unconditioned response, right? Because your eyes dilate when the lights go out and your eyes dilate when the hands clap. But other times the conditioned response could be related. Right? So when the cat eats the food, it gets a certain level of enjoyment. When it hears the can opener, it might not be as much enjoyment. It might not salivate quite as much, but it's going to be related because that cat is anticipating, in this case, that cat food. Okay. So how strong the conditioned response will be will depend on frequency of pairings. You know, do you clap your hands and turn off the lights 20 times, or do you do it 20,000 times? I don't know why you'd do it 20,000 times, but if you did, it would be a whole lot stronger response. It will also depend on timing. So you want to clap your hands and then turn the lights off. You don't clap your hands, wait 5 minutes, and then turn the lights off. And then finally, the intensity of that unconditioned stimulus. You know, if you clap your hands and turn the lights off, yeah, that darkness, that's a relatively mild stimulus. It's going to take a while to learn that relationship. Whereas, and I don't know why you do this, but if you were to clap your hands and then taser somebody, they're going to learn really fast, A, to get nervous when you clap your hands, and B, probably to hate you. But because it is such an intense stimulus, it's probably only going to take one trial before they develop that conditioned response. So we have this cat that has now learned to get excited every time it hears a can opener. And the reason that works is because of the informational value of that conditioned stimulus. So in other words, the cat has learned that the CS, which is the can opener, reliably signals that the UCS, the cat food, is coming soon. Okay, so because it's a reliable signal, the conditioning will be stronger. If you ran the can opener all day long and only gave the cat its food some of those times, it would take a lot longer for it to develop a response, and it would be a lot weaker because the can opener would be a less reliable signal that food is on its way. So now we have to decide, okay, well, is the cat going to respond only to this one can opener? Answer, maybe, maybe not. Sometimes we get what we call generalization. So the person or the animal responds to the original CS and to others that are similar. So you might have a kid that gets bit by a dog and now he develops a fear of all dogs. Or this cat might respond to all small electric household appliances, maybe not just to can openers. Or maybe it will respond to other can openers that have a slightly different sound to them, but are pretty similar to the can opener. So sometimes we get generalization. Other times we get discrimination. So the person or animal responds differently to different stimuli, even when they're similar. So if you have a kid that gets bit by a dog, maybe he doesn't become afraid of all dogs, maybe just that one dog, or maybe just that one breed of dog. And whether we get generalization or discrimination is going to depend a lot on the kid's prior history. You know, has he been around a lot of dogs before, or is this the first time he's ever met a dog? If it's his first time meeting a dog, he's probably just going to be afraid of all of them. If he has met lots of other friendly dogs before, then this kid knows that dogs in general are not a reliable signal that he's about to get bit. So there you'd be more likely to have discrimination. Now, if we stop pairing the can opener with food, right? Or if you want your eyes to no longer dilate when you clap your hands, not a big deal. All you do is you go through extinction. You keep presenting the conditioned stimulus without the UCS. So you run the can opener without giving the cat food, or you clap your hands a bunch without turning the lights out. And eventually the conditioned response is just going to weaken and eventually it will disappear. So another way of putting that is that the conditioned stimulus is no longer a reliable signal for the arrival of the UCS. And so we're going to get, again, a bored cat in response to the can opener because he's like, eh, I keep hearing that noise, not getting food. I'm done with reacting to that one. So that's it for classical conditioning. If you have any questions, don't forget to always email me or ask me in class. And hope you all have a wonderful day.